And for the ones who have been here during the lunch break, I kind of have to disappoint you. There are all the drums back there, but it's not me performing any drumming. I guess it's for the evening event, for the reception, and I'm already curious what will happen here. So I'm really glad to see you all here, and the topic today, Scaling Agile Principles, actually this is something I have been doing for 14 years. I started working Scaling Agile in 2002, and also, my first book that I published was on that topic, so that's the Agile Software Development in the Large. I know it's just now becoming a really hot topic with SAFe and LESS and DAD and all of that. To be honest, for most of those now kind of frameworks that are offered, I'm a little bit disappointed, because for me, Scaling Agile isn't really anything different than Agile. And that's one thing I hope to bring across today to you, that it really relates on how we apply the principles of Agile, and those help us to scale or do any other difficult things, maybe hardware development or applying Agile in a completely different field. So whenever you go back to the principles, you will find some guidance there, and I really hope that this is something you will take away from that session. Okay, about the session. So I plan to run this as a workshop, and we'll see how this will work. And the agenda is first, I want to look at the goals, then we look at the experiences you're all bringing here to this session, then generate insights by examining the principles and then deciding what to do by applying it on difficult issues. So applying the principles on difficult issues and then wrap up and feedback. And for the people who are doing Agile for a longer time, they might think, oh, I have seen an agenda like this before. Yes, it's actually pretty much what you do in a retrospective, right? Where you gather data, generate insight, decide what to do, and this is it. So you can also do this structure that you know from retrospective for other stuff. So maybe that's another takeaway you can have here. Okay, the workshop goal. I mentioned that already. So this is really very, very important to me. And I absolutely hope, and if only like every fourth person in the room understands that Scaling Agile is really the same as just Agile, so Scaling Agile is Agile, then I would be happy. So like sub-goals that I'm having is understanding the importance of the principles for scaling and know how to adjust and adapt to your own needs. So what can you do in order to apply it to the problems you are having? And let's get started for gathering data on your experiences. The way I want to do this is, maybe you know that also for that, which is also used in some of the retrospective, the sailboat metaphor. And the way I want to use that is that, well, for a sailboat, it needs some wind to be pushed forward, and there is also something that's holding it back. So the wind that's pushing it forward is the area I want to first look at, and it is what has helped, or if you haven't scaled Agile yet, what is expected to help when scaling Agile. So what are the things that you think will be easy to do? And I would like you to discuss that with, well, like maybe six people, and maybe either you arrange yourself around the tables, or maybe you can arrange the chairs somehow, and just think about with the six people, what do you think is helping when scaling Agile? What is it that just you think, well, that it has helped me in the past or would help me? And we have 3 minutes for that, and I would like you to take notes, and you can take notes already. We have flip charts on the tables, So you can take a note there. Maybe you want to draw a ship first, a sailboat, and put the wind there, and then, okay, what is it that's pushing that boat? Okay, let's get started. 3 minutes. What's helping when scaling Agile? Okay, so the question here is if it's focusing on distributed Agile as well. So I didn't have distribution in my mind, but if this is the situation you are having here mainly, then that's fine too. So my focus right now was more like on just it's big, but I know most of the things that are big are often distributed. Yeah, right. Question, if you don't have experience on Agile, scaling Agile, this is why I have. What do you expect would help if you scale it? Yeah. Oh, and you don't have to agree with everything. You don't have to have consensus on what you are doing here. So the one person might say, oh, this is helping, and another one says, well, something else is helping. Right, because I just know that this is okay. Thing here. If you now look at what is a really difficult issue, what is the thing that you think is really the hardest when scaling? So it's now looking again at the what has hindered or is expected to hindering scaling Agile, and now what is the main issue, and so it's kind of a sticky issue because you don't really know how to get over that. And it would be great if you could agree on one at your in your group, and if you have then two, then it's okay too. But try to agree on one thing. Okay, let's go. So I heard that, well, I didn't check with everyone, but I checked with many, and I heard that you are done. And I would like to hear about the sticky issues you found. Let's start here. I thought the table here, so we go next then to you. Yeah. Communication and prioritization. Collaboration, yeah. Okay, so then next. There, yeah. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of everything we are talking about. Okay. Then, yeah. Okay, so we make here an emphasis. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Oh, uh-huh. Something else. What about here? Oh, yeah, that's a big one. Two. Maybe here? Dependency. What about? Mm-hmm. So it's similar to this one. Okay. Let's say collocation. Or non-collocation is what you said, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. What about here? Distributed teams, dependencies as well. Mm-hmm. What do you? Noticeable outcomes. How do I write that? Like this? Which probably, well, which relates as well to the other things. So, for example, to the dependencies, it could relate to that. This is why you don't have the outcome. Is there anything else back there? Yeah. Which one? Yeah. What else? Uh-huh. Alignment. External facing teams and customers. And here I have to. Anything else? Say it again. Organization. Mindset, culture, and what was the third one? Training, yeah. It's, so which belongs to culture and mindset, right? Okay, can I hear a few of the things, and I'm not sure if I note them down, or maybe I do, of the things that you think that help or that are easy to scale? What is helping when scaling up? Existing knowledge, yeah. Let me try to keep some of them at least. What else? Best practices and ensuring that they spread, right? What else? Say it again. What is it? There are like three things in at the same time. So I got this one. Organizational support, that's always helpful. And there was something with communication. Periodic, yeah, right. Yeah. I'm sorry. And I didn't know where to look. Innovation, creativity helps. A mature portfolio backlog. So like the big picture. Yeah. Oh yes, that's also a big one. Leadership buy-in. Probably related to organizational support. Alignment, what we had before, as something that's difficult. And of course, it's helping if you are having it. Yeah, that's true. Okay, maybe we'll leave it there unless somebody says, like, I'm really having something very urgent that's missing. Motivation. Okay, something urgent. That's a good list. Okay, so these are now your experiences, what you are seeing that's helping, and also like the difficult things. Well, we didn't go through all difficult things, but through your sticky issues, and we realized already for some that some have a bigger emphasis, or some are also related to each other, so they might ask for the same resolution. I want to go on and first now look at, well, the principles as they are there. So the actual principles as they are defined, and hopefully we can use them to generate insights and then later on apply them to the sticky issues. But that's only the third step. So the first thing I want to look at, well, not really, but you have seen that. I'm pretty sure you have. So the Agile Manifesto. Don't worry, I'm not going over that. With the manifesto, there comes as well the Agile principles, and often people forget to take a look at them, and this is actually what I want to do here. So the Agile principles, this is an abbreviated list of, oh, well, I just did that because I wasn't sure if we have enough handouts, so I put them all on one list, and it's a cluttered slide, I know that, but this is like the full list, the 12 principles as they are defined by the Agile Manifesto. You have on the table a few handouts, which are just those 12 principles. And what I want to do now is that you go together in pairs. So we make the group smaller now, so not as big as we had it right now. And you go in pairs and explore the principles by, well, taking like two or three of them. Don't look at all of them because it's too much and we won't have time that everyone really looks at all of them. It would be great if at a table you could distribute them so that you're not all looking at the same ones in pairs, right? But it's not very strict about that. And so the question that I want to ask here, and the way how you should look at the principles, is how do these two or three principles you are looking at support scaling Agile? And of course, on the other hand as well, how do these principles challenge scaling Agile? So it's a similar question to what we had before, which was more just a general, what's your experience? And now we have the Agile principles from the manifesto, which define what Agile really is. And I want you to look at two or three of them as a pair, looking at what's supporting it and what's challenging. And I said there are handouts at the table, and if I don't know where what's best for you. Should I put on the slide the principles back, or do you want the questions here? The principles, well, there are different opinions. I put the principles. So what's supporting, what's hindering, and in pairs, 2 to 3 principles. And how long? Well, at least 5 minutes, I would guess. And take notes of your findings. Okay, what I would like you to do next is share your insights at the table or in the group you were working with before, because I hope you looked at different principles so you can learn more about the other principles, how they help and how they hinder, right? So just exchange what you found out. Minutes you're sharing at the table. You're done. But you're at first, I would just like to hear back from you if there was anything surprising that you heard when sharing the insights. Yeah. It's difficult to put all the principles in the scaling model. Yeah. However, if we say, although we are scaling and we want to be agile, then this is exactly it. And yeah, you're right. Something else that's surprising. Face-to-face communication, that's really a big one, and it's not easy to solve. Yeah. Yeah. Some might really be easy to just, you can just do that, right? Yeah, right. Integrated software across a lot of teams, yeah. Is anything more like where I think this is really concerning? And do we have one working software, or do we have as many as we have teams here? And it's not like one coherent thing. That's a, yeah, right. That's where everything circles around. Oh, the motivated individuals, because very often if you look like at a scaled up thing, you don't see the individual anymore. It's more like, well, it's a mass of people. Yeah, that's true. It's good that you're asking this now, because that leads me to what I think would be helpful. If we now go, well, I'm not sure if we go through the complete list, but at least to like some of the things that you found, and now we have the first principle, which is the highest priority to satisfy customers through early and continuous delivery of valuable software. And now the question, one of the questions is already, okay, what is valuable software? Well, the answer from my side is, it's what's valuable, A, from the customer or market point of view, and B, it's also valuable from our business strategic point of view. Sometimes, at least that's my trap, oops, that's my trap where I often fall in. I often look only at the market and customer side, but this is not enough. It also has to be in line with our business strategy. That's also a value. Okay, and if we look now at these first principles, what did you find for the ones who have looked at this that's helping or what's challenging here? Providing the value early, and what was it, early and continuous delivery? Okay, and if I now am playing the devil's advocate, how is that different from in the small? You probably have the same issue there. Maybe not, but this is the way you're just saying what is the challenge here sounds to me like, okay, that's a challenge we are having independent if we are scaling up or not. Is that true? Okay. Anything else around that principle? The first one, yeah. Exactly, exactly. So it really, there are at least two things that go with that. One is finding out what will really provide a value to the customer and to our business strategy. So back to your question, that's why I'm looking at you. That's one thing. That might be difficult as well in the small, but it's often harder the bigger you are, because then also the more is implied by the product you're building. It's just harder to understand. Where is that? I think this is what you had here. The big picture is harder to understand. And on the other hand, it is also what you said, that the point that are we really able to deliver early and continuously? Because if we have a lot of people, a lot of teams there, how does integration really work? Does the build really always pass? How long is the build time? And how long do the tests take in order to verify that we really have a valuable software that's working, right? So integration is a really big topic here, which needs to be solved somehow. Yeah. If we go on in order to really understand what the principles are asking from us when we scale up, what about the next one? Has anyone looked at the next one? Exactly, maybe I read this. So, welcome changing requirements. Even late in development, agile processes harness change for the customer's competitive advantage. So you're saying the biggest point here is that one, what you have found out about the sticky issue already. And now the principle says, okay, but if we are agile, this is what we do, right? So we still wanna welcome the change in requirements. Maybe what you need to do up front is providing a structure with the team that allows to make those changes. So looking at the dependencies from a different angle. Ah, very good. That sometimes is the case, right? Very good. Very good. Excellence. Yeah. That's a very great contribution here, because it's very often so, if you look at one principle only, it might shift you into a direction. If you overdo that, then it's not doing really any good. So for example, if you really kind of welcome the changes all the time and you're not taking care of the quality of the system, then you create just a mess, right? So it doesn't, so very often one principle can't go without another one, and the two you picked are really great ones, so the attention to simplicity and to technical excellence, right? Is there anything else around the changing requirements that you came up with? Or should we move on? Yeah, there's one more. So the reworks, which is again the quality in which way we deliver it at first hand, right? Well, of course, it might as well be we have understood something in the wrong way. But very often, at least the way you're saying that, it's maybe we deliver something that's buggy, and that's why it's safe in the room right now. I don't know. I once learned for any kind of session, disturbances take precedence. So if I now just do like nothing has happened, it will not really work. But I see this one is coming up, and here something is coming up. Let's see if I can make the slides work again. Something is happening here, but not there. So I see it on the monitor, but I don't see it here. It's coming. So I have to be patient. Is this what you're saying? I'm not always good at that. Okay. So, yeah, it's coming, and so I trust it will be working. So we set the rework and the buggy delivery might be one thing that hinders the changing, welcoming the change. That is, yeah. Well, it's actually independent if we are in the small or in the large, but it's a very important point, and the point is, in case you didn't understand, if you're welcoming changes all the time and you are not saying like, okay, this also has an impact on what we are doing, then you might not be able to hit the deadline, right? Or you might not be able to deliver what all has been committed to, because there's always those changes coming in. So the thing is, probably the next, is it the next? No. The two after, the business people and developers must work together daily throughout the project, is very close to related to that, because it requires an understanding what that change really means, because we are busy implementing that change. And if it's really so important, then this is fine, but it might have the cost that something else will not get implemented, at least not in the same amount of time, right? So yeah, very good point. Okay, let's go to the third one, which is maybe what I should do is going back here now that we have the slides, and so you see this better, right? If we go to the third one, which says deliver working software frequently from a couple of weeks to a couple of months with a preference to the shorter time scale, anything you found here that makes scaling easy or challenging? That the scale team is supporting this. So in general, focusing on that principle, you're saying is supporting scaling up. Yeah, I absolutely agree. I absolutely agree. Anything else to that? Actually, I think I take a different approach here, which is I think you don't have another chance, really. And I know there were times, and still there are some people discussing that and saying, well, but if you are in the large or if you are distributed or whatever you are struggling with, then this takes more coordination, kind of the, also the collaboration part. And therefore, that's what people are discussing sometimes, therefore, we want to have longer iterations or sprints for reducing that coordination effort. But of course, I guess, for you as well, the longer the period is that we are not coordinating, the harder it will become, right, to really collaborate. That's also why I see this from the other angle and saying, okay, the higher the risk is that we are having, the shorter the iteration should be. Because with every iteration or every sprint, if you will, we get the feedback, and only with the feedback we can A, learn, and B, correct what we are doing. And of course we want to know also or get the big picture on a daily basis. That's, at least to my experience, often hard to do this really every day. But at least on the iteration length, you get the feedback over what's happening with all those teams, with all the development effort in that project, product development you are in. So it's really, as I said, it's supporting scaling in a way that it's reducing the risk. And if you will, everything we are doing in Agile is about getting feedback. And this is kind of the biggest thing with that. So the feedback on the development effort. Of course, we have also other things like the feedback about the valuable software with the customer, which was the first principle, for example. Does this answer it? Well, I said I take a different angle to that. So I think there is no question then focusing on it. Right. Yeah. That's true. However, if you can't integrate and you can't deliver and you can't test it, this means, I'm sorry, but you're not doing really anything. Because there's nothing. Who was that before? Someone said this with the working software is the primary measure of progress when I just did a first round of surprising and whatever. If there is no working software, then there isn't anything, right? So, and that's why I said there. I don't see any chance around that. So I think this is what we have to focus on. And speaking of automation, yeah, it's a big topic. That means sometimes that we have to put all our forces on automation and not so much on implementation of new features, although of course sales and marketing always wants us to focus on implementing new features. But if we are not good in integrating, delivering, testing and all of that, then it doesn't help. We can implement as many features as we want because will not be able to ship them. So this is actually the thing that helps us staying in the market or getting a foot in the market, both. it's a big thing around automation, that's true. Anything else about that, or should we move on to the next? So the next one is, business people and developers must work together daily throughout the project. Did anyone have that principle, and what were your findings? So they can be far away, or they are too busy. Actually, this is also something I sometimes see in the small as well. So it's not always only a scaling up problem, but it's harder when scaling up. Absolutely. Same thing. Yeah. And still, the thing is, if we don't do that, and we do all the other things we have been talking about, then we might build stuff nobody really wants. And we have a similar problem than if we don't ship at all. Yeah, well, what you need to do is really to ensure that every team has access to business people. And there are different ways how you can arrange that or manage that. So one thing is, for example, is if they are far away, then you have to train people at your site who can answer that and who are in closer contact than on a regular basis with real business people. So more a shadowing concept also. But ignoring it and saying, well, okay, we don't have the people, that doesn't help. There is, you need to focus on that. Yeah. Then, the motivation. Did we have that somewhere? It was here, right? Motivation helps. Build projects around motivated individuals. Give them the environment and support they need and trust them to get the job done. What about this? Did anyone take that principle? If not, then we can also skip it and go to Mike. From my experience here, I think this is very much also related to self-organization, the motivated individuals, and it is, of course, related to leadership and management in general. And yeah. To me, the key thing here is, maybe it's too obvious for you, I don't know, is cross-functional teams. Because only within a cross-functional team, you are able, as a team, A, to take full responsibility about what you're building, and B, see the result. And this is something that I think is the thing that provides the highest motivation to people. If they see what they're really building, and it's not like I'm building here the UI, but some team in a different country is doing something with that UI and making some value for a customer out of that. And maybe there is a third team implied with that. So for me, really, the structure of the team is the most important thing here. And again, it goes together with the self-organization. So having cross-functional teams who can take over full responsibility for a feature, really. So if it's smaller, then it's a story. And they are not dependent on somebody else for finishing that story or that feature. This provides the highest motivation. And also, it's the key to self-organization. So that's my take on that. So the structuring is the main answer here. That's an interesting point. So the question is, as a newcomer in a Scrum team, it's harder because it's cross-functional. And actually, this is not my experience. That's a thing that I hear the most often with my clients, that they are saying they are really surprised when new people are joining, how quickly they come up to speed. And it is because, again, the motivation, I assume, because the team as a team holds together and is interested in also helping the other person to understand, and there's almost everyone who can show something and mentor. We don't have the time to self-learning. Well, that's the whole question about how do people deal with velocity, which is actually not really part of, well, it is part with the sustainable development, the number 8 here. But it's not really in the principles, but often people understand in a team velocity as productivity and not as a capability planning tool. And if you look at this as a capability planning tool, then you plan learning in, right? So that's, a wrong understanding. However, it's not related to scaling. That you have that as well somewhere else. And again, the thing that I'm hearing often and what I'm experiencing is that in cross-functional teams and in Scrum teams in general, it's much easier for new people to come in and to learn what's going on and be helpful almost from day one in some way or the other. So that was the motivation part. If we move on to number 6, the most efficient and effective method of conveying information to and within a development team is face-to-face conversation. That was the big one that was mentioned right away. That's the challenge if we are scaling up. Okay, so what does it mean for scaling up? Frequent communication, absolutely. So it's in the principle, and maybe you say afterwards when you leave here and say, oh, Jutta takes the principle as a Bible or something. And on the one hand, maybe I really do that because I think either we want to be agile or we don't want to be agile. And so the principles say this is the kind of the definition of agile. And therefore, if face-to-face is really the thing that's so important, we have to ensure that something is happening here. And as you are saying, for example, periodic conversation or communication is one thing. And did you mention that earlier? Somebody mentioned it here. Was it you as well? That this is the thing that's helping. Yeah. Right. Absolutely. I agree completely. It's, well, actually, for probably almost all the principles, I'm not saying it's easy to apply them. However, what I think, if this is something that's important for Agile, then we have to strive in order to make it happen. And one way, for example, what you're saying right now is more like a distributed setting is there are different answers to that. But one answer is there are times where we meet as well for a distributed setting. That's at least in the projects I'm working on. And we ensure that whenever we meet, which might be not frequent enough, but there are times we meet at different locations. We are not meeting at the same location all the time, and just because of that, different people have a chance to get to know to other people on the team, because not everyone will be traveling, of course, if it's really large. That's one thing. The other thing is, for example, the closer we are together and we are large, the more frequent we meet face to face, but the shorter the time frame is we are meeting. And the further apart we are, the less frequent we see each other, but the longer the time frame is, the duration we are seeing each other. It can be go up to expatriates, yeah, who work at another site for a really long period of time in order to understand the different mindset, culture, ensuring the connection between sites. Or it can just be that, some people go to another site maybe for 2 weeks, so something in between there. And speaking of like now I'm from Germany, I'm now in India. If I have a team in India, which I actually have right now, then if I go there, I don't go there for one meeting, 1 hour, or probably not even for a day. The least I'm going there is for a week. And if it's something that's quite close, so maybe two sites in India, then you can see each other more often because it's not so far, but not for such a long time, of course, not for 1 week. So that's the kind of the answer. It's still important to ensure face-to-face, and still at least what we are doing is we strive for making it happen as good as we can in the framework we are in. And it's always on the top of my list of the top high risks, that if we are not focusing on it, then probably other stuff is not working. Well, no wonder that this was mentioned first, the communication and collaboration. Because if this is not working, probably integration and automation will as well not work, because everyone is doing something different and we are not really working together. That's why it's so important. Working software is a primary measure of progress. I know we have talked about this already, so I just want to check, is there anything that we haven't talked about yet that you, if you have discussed that at all? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. So who focuses on integration and testing perspective? Of course, there are, with like a lot of things, there are different answers to that. So I made good experiences with, we have someone per team ensuring that, and it could be that it's not a person, but a role which is changing amongst the team members. So we have in every team at least one person ensuring, for example, for a sprint, that integration is working. And therefore, because we have somebody like that in every team, they get together to be virtually if there is any problem. And also work on automation. That's one thing. Another thing that we have done successfully was having a separate team focusing on integration and build only, so on all the automation around that. So it's not that if something isn't working with integration that they have to fix it, that's not the thing, but ensuring that integration and build is automated and it's fast. So it's optimizing integration and build. So these are kind of the two strategies that we used. And actually a good idea might be if you're struggling with this a lot, so maybe their first step is to come up with a team doing that so that you have a good foundation for it, and then dissolve the team and decentralize it to all the different Scrum teams. So sometimes you have like different, depending where you are right now, different steps in between. Yeah, which relates of course to working software. Okay, did anyone pick the Agile processes promote sustainable development? The sponsors, developers, and users should be able to maintain a constant pace indefinitely. I would think so too, and I don't see actually something that's specifically different than in the small. At least right now, nothing comes to my mind. So it's, if you're struggling with it in the small, you might struggle as well in the large, but you can take it as a leverage for scaling up. Yeah. We talked a little bit about the other two, the next one is continuous attention to technical excellence and good design enhances agility. Any insights about that? Yeah, I agree. The thing that I see sometimes is that people don't pay attention to that, and they struggle with it on one side with one team already, and then they scale up and they wonder why it's not getting any better. So that's something you might struggle with anyway, and the problem just gets bigger and bigger the more you scale up. So, yeah, exactly. That's absolutely true. And the major thing, and you probably have heard about that too, is the communities of practices that help as well spreading the knowledge about how to do this and that, so how to focus on technical excellence or what kind of tests and so on to use for that. Simplicity, the art of maximizing the amount of work not done is essential. That's true. You plan for it, and I would like even to add to this principle that simplicity is essential for scaling up. And the reason is, again, the thing that you brought up here with the dependencies. If you don't focus on that, then this will get harder. And on the other hand, what I've seen as well is if you're not focusing on simplicity, it's also harder to understand what's going on in the system for everyone. And the bigger the effort is, so the more teams and people you are having here, the more likely it is that there are also some people who might not understand it. So complexity is an enemy for scaling up. And it's like here, Cowboy coders also, they really hinder scaling up. Okay, I think we talked also about the next one at least a bit. The best architectures, requirements, and designs emerge from self-organizing teams. I talked about self-organizing teams before, however, not about the other part, the architectures, requirements, designs. Anything about that? Did anyone pick on that? Talk about that. Probably most talked about the upper ones. Yeah. It will not work. I agree. Yeah, it will not work. Well, I wouldn't really say yes to that, and the reason why I'm not saying yes is because I think it depends very much on the team structure. And the thing that says here, the architecture requirements designs, where you see this is kind of everything that's involved in creating software, speaks already about cross-functional teams. And that's the key thing here, really. If you do have cross-functional teams all over the place when you are scaling up, then it's not really any different from a team perspective. What you need as well is then the communication across teams. But still from the team perspective and ensuring architecture requirements designs, and then if you also have like communities of practice, that's not a big thing then. Absolutely. Let me just finish the next one, and I want to get back to this. Because then we are through with this. So the last one is, at regular intervals, the team reflects on how to become more effective, then tunes and adjusts its behavior accordingly. Anything about that one? Any specifics? So retrospectives, still, they are important, and the learning happens with the retrospectives. And of course, the thing might be, if you are completely distributed, that you need some tools for doing that, or if you are, actually this session wasn't really focusing on distribution, more on scaling up, but still, if you have a lot of teams, then you need to think about as well having retrospective at the scaled up level. And, well, running out of time. Well, I think I still have this in mind, what you said about aligning the architecture. And I still think what we do now that we have talked about the principles to look at deciding what to do. And what I would like to do is to look at your sticky issue at your table. And we take 5 minutes to look at how do those principles help solving that one sticky issue that you came up with? So, and you can pick just like a couple of principles and find out how they help you there. And I want to spend really only maybe 3 minutes on that, and then we wrap this up, and also I want to talk about the architecture part then again. So if you look at your sticky issue and the principles, how we talked about them now, and see how they help for your sticky issue here. 3 minutes to that. So the 3 minutes are up. And my question is, did you find now, after we talked about the principles, something that's helping with your sticky issue? I see some of you are still in discussion. So did you find that any of the principles help resolving the sticky issue that you came up with? Yeah. But, yeah. We're starting. The dependency was yours? Ah, right. So if you focus on the technical excellence, it helps with the dependencies, right? Uh-huh. Yeah, that's what we talked about beforehand. And yeah. Okay, yeah, right. And I think you were first and then you. Uh-huh. Yeah. So the motivation part is your answer to that. Actually, I would think the answer to that is as well focusing on really the actual values and understanding them. What about you? Yeah, integration helps to resolve the dependency. And then again, we are at your favorite topic, automation. Yeah. Anything else that you found? Principles that help with your sticky issue? So you are addressing it with collaboration. And structure of the teams, I understand that. Right. Yeah. Right. And anything from here, or was that mentioned as well already? Okay. So there was still this open question about the, well, question, it was more a comment on the architecture and how to create the alignment. Well, we have here the external facing alignment. So for the architecture, actually, the answer is not so much different than what I gave already for integration. So first of all, the answer was, well, it depends what is your biggest problem here right now, and also the situation you are in. So for integration, I say, okay, if you are not really able to deliver, then maybe you need a team that focuses on that and ensuring that the build works and is fast and is automated. And so the same answer is here too. If you are really struggling with the architecture, you might need a team that's providing a service which is creating the architecture for the other teams working on that architecture. And once that architecture is in place and maybe the complexity is not really high in your system, then you don't need this, but you have more it decentralized, as I said, with the integration, and you have like people in every team, or it's a role in every team that ensures the adherence to the architectural rules, so that you have conceptual integrity here. So it depends on how vague is the architecture, how complex it is, and how many changes you are having here. And this depends on the support that you have to provide. And the kind of the lowest spectrum, you don't have a lot of changes in the architecture, your system isn't really complex, then it might mean that you only have a community of practice coming together at times and sorting things out. And if you are at the other end of the spectrum and you have a lot of changes going on there in the architecture, then you need really people focusing on that only, because if you don't, this would hinder everyone else to work on their stuff. So the answer is for a lot of things, it depends. And I know we are almost done here, and I would like you to take maybe 30 seconds and reflect. What is that? Yeah. To. So to conclude about the principles, it is for scaling up, the principles are still valid. And that's why I made that entering statement that scaling agile is still agile. It's not really different. However, applying those principles might be harder. And actually what we didn't really talk about, well, we talked about it indirectly. Often we think they can't be applied because we are scaling up, because some other rules have to put in place, which is not true. They are still, these are still the guiding principles for Agile, no matter if we are scaling or not. And that's just the example with the face-to-face. It is hard, to do that. And you will not be able to do this on a daily basis. But if you understand that it's important in order to be agile, then you will ensure to have it as often as possible and in different ways. As I said, like just different meeting locations and ensuring the face-to-face this way. So applying the principles still hold true. And actually, now the time is up anyway, and I wanted to do, maybe this is your little homework, to reflect on what is your key takeaway from that. And maybe at least I heard this kind of fear. My goal was not to talk about like less and safe, but my goal was to understand what is the kind of the definition of agile and how does it still hold true in scaling up. That there isn't really anything else we need. So thank you very much. I know that we are to the end here today, and I hope you have some takeaways from that session here, and enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you.